All right, we are back. It is 10:44. So I think that I certainly don't want to cut off conversation. I think that we've kind of zeroed in on a number of things that, well, we keep, you know, kind of peeling the onion and making progress. And it seems to me that there's a few buckets of items that we're all concerned about, and that there's now more outreach from the regulated community, and perhaps there will be more conversations with them. In my mind, it may be time to focus on, I am still troubled by the frequency. I, like Commissioner Orden, I used to do timesheets. I have a feeling that she was more diligent about it than I was. I didn't just always set aside that, you know, 10:30, 1 hour at the end of the day. And I don't want this to be the part-time job of lobbyists. I think that transparency is incredibly important. I think that every court from the Supreme Court to the Superior Courts has acknowledged the idea that when the public is armed with information about who is trying to sway the decisions of their elected officials, that our representative democracy just works better. But I also don't think that we should regulate people out of business. And there's, you know, those are two interests that are difficult to balance. The 10-day deadline is something that we've heard from Ms. Hines that it can take basically 10 to 15 days at the end of a quarter. So the 10-day deadline seems to be something that maybe we could massage. The listing of contacts, I don't know if we want to talk more about these things now or if we want to have additional meetings with the regulated community and then talk about it. The listing of contacts, I am concerned about only because of the kind of overwhelming pattern of comments that we got, that could be problematic. And there's this looming 501c3 issue. And so I would open it up for, are there other issues that we want to ask the staff to go back and focus on? Are there other issues that we want to discuss today?
I don't necessarily, there is one that we have not discussed, which is the private cause of action.
Yes, thank you.
Exactly how that would work and how has it worked in the past in the campaign financing area. I come with a prejudice toward private causes of action. I think there are, because of SLAPP and anti-SLAPP laws, I think there are a lot of protections for bringing frivolous lawsuits. So I come from that point of view, but to have it sort of just dropped in with all the other issues, I think we need a little bit more about how that would work. On the reporting of who and when and about what, I mean, that is to me absolutely crucial that it be expanded from what we have now. And the reason, of course, for that is that we have seen some of the reporting, some of the absolutely legal, absolutely appropriate, absolutely well done reporting that gives zero information to people who are trying to find out what's going on. You can't figure out, you know, it happens in downtown Los Angeles, it happens with 17 departments. Maybe one department had 4 minutes and there's been 3 weeks of work with another department. So there absolutely must be a dramatic change from where we are today.
May I comment on that?
Yes.
I do agree with that, and just to, I hope the commission and the regulated community and the public know that staff tried as hard as it could, and I believe accomplished the goal of trying to take a reasonable approach to this. And here, and I'll give you an example why. When we're looking at contacts and trying to add that increased specificity, we look at what, like I mentioned earlier, what other jurisdictions are doing. San Diego requires disclosure of certain officials that are contacted, including their name, but not the date. San Francisco requires the name and the date. San Jose requires the name, the date of every communication, and even the method of communication, whether by phone, by email, by correspondence. because we're, this is a new concept to the Los Angeles regulated community, we again try to take a measured, reasonable approach. And by doing that, it's not the name of the city official, it is the their title and the date of the communication. And those are, and I think it's very key that we remember this too, we're talking about compensated communication, going back to what Mark mentioned earlier. We're talking about compensated, not your hi, how's it going in the middle of the hallway, but you're being compensated to contact a city official to influence them on a legislative or
That's a good clarification. Sure. So let's say somebody goes into, I think Mr. England or something, somebody goes into council chambers and they're representing one issue and they happen to see somebody and they're representing another issue, and maybe they see two or three people, right? And then they're like, oh, hey, blah, 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 did you get my email about this? Oh, okay, well, can we meet about it? So maybe there are two or three interactions. Are those are reportable?
Usually when we have those kind of informal advice questions, we all deliberate, but I will say if the lobbyist, registered lobbyist, doesn't, you know, make that contact at city council chambers, he or she is there for another reason, meets the city official and they talk about an issue, and then that lobbyist goes and bills the client for the 15-minute conversation, yeah, that would be reported.
I see. So it's based on billable.
I would put a little bit of a spin on that, though, because the requirement would be the reporting of the date of a direct communication, and specifically excluded from the definition of direct communication is conversations about ministerial actions, like scheduling a meeting.
Oh, okay.
So that would not.
Okay, count. Great.
And I do think your charts are extraordinary.
That's
extremely
yeah.
helpful.
That was great.
And raise some questions, which I'd be ready to get answers from.
To the extent that this is possible, you said, you know, that's the type of thing where if we get a call, we have to deliberate. I just think of the justices who write in the First Amendment area, if you have to think about whether or not you can do something, it's potentially chilling. So I know it's really difficult to draw lines in these cases. And the fact that you're getting calls, I mean, people are really honestly trying to comply with the rules. But to the extent that there is a way where we're getting at what we want to get at, which is who's trying to influence our elected officials, who are they compensated by, and you know, how is that affecting our officials, basically, how is that affecting their credibility, how is that affecting their integrity, how is that affecting their decision-making process without you know, jamming the advice line. And I know that's like, if you could thread this needle and then this needle and then this even smaller needle, that'd be great.
Generally speaking, you know, every, and this has been my experience, especially working at the Federal Election Commission, laws always require some interpretation by staff. I cannot begin to tell you how many times a day at the Federal Election Commission I receive a call. We do receive, routinely, but not every day, but we will receive randomly informal advice calls, and it is just for clarification. And the one thing I heard in my outreach to registered lobbyists and lobbying entities was how responsive we were whenever they did have questions, whether it's a simple question as to our electronic filing system, or it's a question, hey, I'm thinking about doing this, you know, is this okay or not? I think that's regular practice.
Is there So I have the list of five things that I laid out before, and then Commissioner Orban reminded me about the fifth, the private cause of action.
Yes.
That I think that we would like you to focus on, but are there any other comments from my fellow commissioners before we end this item? Is there anything else that we want to think about? Yeah.
I'll just add, somebody raised the need to focus, I think they meant instead. And I'd like to hear more about that today, but just like to hear more about what work is being done. I heard the word dramatic used in terms of changes needed. I'm not sure I agree, but I think I'd like to hear more on what kind of changes and what would justify them. I'm not sure I've heard justification. Dramatic.
It was not dramatic, but dramatic in the sense of a change from today's rules specifically as to who, when, where, where now you could spend thousands and thousands of dollars talking about downtown Los Angeles and talking to, quote, the city, and that, you know, you could comply with our current law. And it just needs so much, it's a dramatic change to have more detail, is what I mean. That's the dramatic part.
Okay, then that's really dramatic change in terms of our policy. But I would recommend or implore or ask if you could work, have a one or series of working group meetings with different communities, maybe on different topical issues, particularly on the C3 issue, as I mentioned, to really, and I heard Mr. Lowe say, like, there's some, you know, a lot of credence given to the comments given, you're willing to, you know, modify based on some of those. I think that would be a really smart and inclusive next step for this. And then and some thought given to, is this in terms of focus area, is this, are these changes going to get at the what is really haunting us in terms of improper behavior? And then that speaks to the unregistered lobbying question. I think that would be very helpful.
I appreciate that. We'll get that information. We'll continue our aggressive outreach. And if I may ask, since we've had a lot of discussion on here, just to kind of get a sense of where the commission's going to help guide staff, when we're talking about the deadline, we're trying to be, like I mentioned earlier, we're trying to be as reasonable throughout mm-hmm. possible. So I did see, you know, there are 14 states that have monthly reports, 8 of them smaller than Los Angeles when it comes to size, and their deadlines usually fall within 10 to 15 days. Would 15 days be something that mass members of the commission, that kind of increase, be beneficial?
I think it sounds better. And I think asking someone like Ms. Hines, you know, I think she said it's a minimum of 10 to 15 days. So maybe if it's 15 days and she's like pulling her hair out, sure. maybe it's 17 days, you know, maybe it's 18, especially if, you know, if those states are smaller than Los Angeles as a whole. Again, like I'm all for transparency. And I want to make sure that the people that are complying and we know are going to comply, that we are making it easier.
Absolutely. And it's important to remember, because we're talking about two extra reports a year, we're talking about each one of those reports having essentially 33% less activity.
Let's stuff it up.
Yeah.
Sure.
So
and
I mean,
No.
But here's the thing is that, you know,
it's Sam Alito in the background. Not true.
You know, I mean, so I haven't done lobbying reports, but I have been finance director on campaigns, and so I know the level of detail, and so it still is additional paperwork. It, you know, and again, noting that the people in the room are showing up, they're going to show up, they want to do the best. They want it to be right because they want to be in compliance, but I don't doubt that it will still be a significant undertaking. So figuring out how it's not as significant, I think, is, you know, the direction we should go.
Commissioner Orden said something, and before we leave this, I would like to lend more support to it, which is, I think we kind of, and I'm guilty of this, we kind of wax poetic about transparency and how important it is to be able to have this information to hold our public officials accountable, and then we don't really think about exactly the mode of delivery. And I think that there's two things that we should be thinking about. One is clearly it's the language of the MLO, and I think that's really important. And then two, it's the visual distribution. And I think we can all sit here and talk about how great we're going to feel that we're getting the public the right information, but I'm not totally convinced how many people are actually looking. The press corps is dwindling, how many people are actually looking at that. And so I very much want to make sure that we're striking the right balance between the public's right to know and not and again, regulating people kind of out of business or out of sanity. And at the same token, I think we need to be mindful of the fact that we all live in a bit of a bubble where we think about these things a lot, and we need to make sure that we find a way that, I mean, Commissioner Orden said something like, you know, you can read these and have no idea what's going on. And to me, that's the overarching goal here.
And you would read it very, very late, and whatever did go on was a month and a half ago.
And I think to Commissioner Campos's point that, like, if the intent, you know, to figure out how we bring in unregistered lobbyists, that if the point is to make sure that the public knows what's going on, we want people who are potentially out of compliance being the ones that we're figuring out how to regulate more.
Do you have enough to go forward? If the answer is no, let's have that moment now.
Yes, I believe I do.
Are you just being polite? Yes, you believe you are.
I would like to ask a process question. At the previous meetings that we've had discussions about concepts, it has been extremely helpful for the commissioners to say we approve in concept this recommendation, not that recommendation. Is it fair to say that aside from the items that have been mentioned as discrete items to revisit at future meetings, that there's general conceptual consensus on the other recommendations that have been made?
So you want to make sure that not everything is open up for an endless review.
That would be great.
Okay.
Yes.
So as I said, my concerns fall into those five buckets. But why don't we go down the line?
I think my concerns would be there, and some of them I would be willing to vote on today. But we didn't talk, although we got in our comments various complaints about the number of the $5,000, mm-hmm. even some who didn't want any compensation to be the test at all. So there are some in here that we really haven't talked about very much here. I think we probably have a consensus on, so we could probably take some of those things off the table, or however you think is best.
We could kind of, by process of elimination, conceptually approve the portions that we're not concerned about if we have at least three people who are conceptually, theoretically comfortable with that. So, and I do think that we kind of owe it to the staff to start to narrow this down.
I mean, I have a suggestion, but please. We may not be ready for it. It might be a good one to use when we are ready for it, which is actually to take the work that you've done here in terms of the charts so that you have, mm-hmm. you know, lobbying activities, lobbying entity. Do we have any concern about what we're doing with lobbying entity? Lobbying firm, you know, keeps going through all of those, and if there's no real objection, fundraising solicitation, poster sponsor, you could do that, and maybe we want to do it next time. I also thought maybe I don't know if scheduling ever works out, but sometimes maybe have a meeting even sooner than 2 months from now.
Yeah, that's fine too. Well, what do we think about the charts? Should we go, are we comfortable going through and deciding if there's consensus on issues right now? Mr. Sutton, are you comfortable?
Frankly, not at all. there's so many issues here, and as you can hear, in 2 minutes, the lobbying community focused on the most glaring changes. But for instance, there's one issue Armand's done so much work, and the staff, but one issue I didn't even know about, I think it sounds about the $5,000 filers and ongoing reporting, I missed that, because the redline version came out on Thursday. So, and there are so many other issues about fundraising solicitations and payments to lobbying firm employees and expanding the gift prohibitions to apply to lobbyist employers that are very important issues that I think the chart is a great way of doing it, and maybe streamlining the chart and making it issues. But personally, we would think that the lobbying community has not been given enough notice to comment on all of those things because just of the volume of what was presented last Thursday.
I don't want to put any words into anybody's mouth.
Commissioner Overstreet and Commissioner Levinson have been on the commission for a couple of years.
And that's good.
I've been on the commission for 2 years, but still, I don't believe that Commissioner Borden and Commissioner Campos have, we weighed in on these things, as you can see from the reports, over the course of the last 2 years. So perhaps we could table, I think, you know, we are trying to focus on things. Perhaps we could table the chart, perhaps until the next meeting, just so the newer commissioners can get up to speed. And also, I know we've been talking about this for a long time, and we had lots of discussions on the caps and the definitions, but you know, we could always use some new discussion, or if there's something that Mr. Sutton or one of the other lobbying entities hasn't had a chance to weigh on, because they've been focusing on these five or six items that we've been discussing today.
I appreciate that. I also got this from the first time on Thursday, so I appreciate that. And I mean, we're all about transparency, but I think having a process that feels very transparent is important, and it seems like we're getting closer.
So I love the chart idea, and I want to make sure that everybody feels up and running and ready for that. So I think we should absolutely plan on doing that next time. And I think that we owe it to the staff to be ready to pull the trigger on some things. I also think that if there's agreement on anything, it's that there's room for improvement, and the longer we wait, the longer this is not improved. So let's table the chart idea, it sounds like, even though I absolutely think that that is the best and most effective way of going through it. And it sounds like what we have consensus for is to ask you to focus on our five concerns. And with I would say, to the extent that this is helpful, the understanding that I know that there's been basically 18 months of outreach on the other provisions, and that these are documents that have been available, I think we should try and focus our attention on the new issues, and to the extent possible, try not to reopen, but still be mindful of the fact that we want to get it right. Is that a motion?
It's not good.
All right, let's theoretically decide to move off of item number 6. Do I have a second?
A second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.